Welcome. I'm City Councilor Marianne LaBarge. I'm the City Councilor from Ward 6 and Chair on the Committee on Social Services, Veterans, Cultural, and Recreation. To my right, I'd like to introduce the City Councilor from Ward 4, Gina Louisiera. And from Ward 7 is City Councilor Alyssa Klein. I also would like to announce that this meeting is being audio-video recording that is being taken both by NCTV and also by Adam Cohen from the North Street Association. I would like approval of the minutes of October 14, 2014, public hearing on the resolution of vibrant sidewalks, and also the minutes of October 20th, 2014. Okay, so we're supposed to be having Jay Shetty, Vice President of Shelter and Housing from ServiceNet, and they might be having problems finding parking, so give them some time. Not unless you would like to move up.
Yeah,
I think that we committee with the discussion on the resolution of vibrant sidewalks.
Yeah.
Okay. We know for the month of December, the 2 hours will be spent strictly on doing a dialogue, looking at the language, adding language or deleting language. Mm-hmm. Also, I talked with Wendy and she said we do have to open it up to the public. So I think I will do that first.
Open what up? The meeting?
This meeting, yes, if somebody wants to talk.
They're always open. Huh?
Yeah, well, sometimes we don't. So we will open that right off the bat. As soon as we come in, we'll ask the public if they would like to speak. And is there anything that you want to suggest for that meeting?
No, I mean, I think, well, I guess I'll say something. So we have copies of the minutes that Pam took for us.
Yes.
In both of the hearings.
Yes.
And I have pretty extensive notes that I took, and I'm happy to share those with you if you feel like it would be useful. And if you have any, it'd be great, because sometimes, you know, different people hear and record different things. And what I was planning on doing is just going through all of these different pieces, the minutes in my own personal notes, and just kind of highlighting anything that was kind of a recurrent theme that we heard, and any discussion of particular language that people, for instance, that John Newman suggested a couple of things, a couple of different people suggested a couple of different things, and just maybe putting those out there for our discussion and decide if we do in fact want to kind of alter language, if there's anything we want to take out. I'm just kind of doing a bit of a brainstorming session, I guess. Is that what you two have in mind?
I know that Councilor Adams has been working on amendments based on what Mr. Newman had suggested.
Is he submitting those stuff to
the I believe he is. I would check with him again. I sent him, I think the timeline and said that December would be the month to do it.
Did he send you something official?
No. We had it taped. We took it right off the tape. Exactly what Bill Newman had stated.
Right. So but if we're getting official language.
Oh, from Bill?
No, from Council. I will check.
You're giving official language from him.
Councilor Adams had been, based on the public hearing, was working on crafting some new language based on what Mr. Newman had said.
And making it an official language.
Right. Incorporating those ideas into
it. Okay, that's great. I also talked with Wendy after we're finished and we are done with the language, put it together, adding language, deleting language. It does not go to ordinance, it comes back to City Council when we set for second approval. If not that night of City Council, City Councilors can say, we'd like to send it back to ordinance.
Okay.
procedurally, do we need to, anything that we want to change, do we need to do it, craft it as amendments? Or can we just kind of rewrite essentially?
Okay, so, well, if you ever notice on ordinance where they delete and add, so we would just go away and put them in. But I wanted to clarify that with Wendy. Does, do we automatically send it to ordinance? Where does it go? She said, because it's done its first reading, you're spending time in your committee either adding or either deleting language. Once you're completed, then send it to City Council. City Council can make a recommendation. Send it back to ordinance or go ahead and do the second
Is there any chance that we can request that? Because I wonder if it would, just for her to be the person that's kind of recording our ideas and changing the language, if maybe we can either schedule the meeting for 4:30 so she can be here from the start, or if we have any other business for the first half hour till she gets here, or we could just, I guess, be discussing for the first half hour.
Discuss. And if we have people in the audience, I mean...
Yeah, there might be public comment.
I know, I was wishing that Wendy would let her out earlier, but from the way.
No, so the public comment would not be in the minutes. But, I mean, in the hearing, the comments are in the minutes, but the public comment for our community would not be in the minutes.
No, it wouldn't be recorded.
So we could do that before.
Yeah. The roof issues are there, so it'll be on hers.
Okay, sounds like a plan.
Sounds like a plan. Great. Do you think maybe we might want to do another hearing? I have to tell you, Alyssa, when the meeting was, I think we did very well in Northampton, and especially Florence. And when I had talked with Bill Newman about, he told me to send him a flyer, the fact that I mailed it to his office. He said, I will be there.
Yeah.
And so happy he was there, because I explained the situation to him, and I was happy about that.
You know, now that I think of it, I took notes by hand for the first violent sidewalk thing, so I'm not going to transcribe them, but I wish I'd be able to do a second one if I do it in my account.
Oh, great. I wish I knew how to do short one.
Yeah, but then no one wants to read it.
I know.
And then there's something else here. What's on the agenda? Marianne, you wanted to talk about the December.
That was it. We just talked about it, how we were going to do it, how we were going to lay it out.
Is that the only other thing on the agenda?
Yep.
Yeah.
Right there.
Yep. Got it.
Discuss the resolution on Biden signing.
Yep.
That was number 9 that I took out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then the committee will discuss the resolution on Biden sidewalk.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you pretty well covered quite a bit of it, Alyssa and both you and Lily.
So if those folks forgot to come.
They, I'll tell you right now,
you
never forget to come.
Yeah.
I think they might be having a parking problem.
Okay.
You've met Jay before from ServiceNet on the shelters.
Did you see at the CGBG thing? I have met Katie.
Have you met Katie? Yeah, she's a new employee.
How did the veterans go for it?
Good. It was cool.
Okay. Did you go to the breakfast? Was it a breakfast or lunch?
Saturday?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, I always thought that would be interesting.
Is it packed?
There was people there, but I thought last year for this morning, in case.
Yeah.
Contrary to popular belief, we do not have a operating.
I would go right now.
Okay. I want to thank the both of you for being here. Apparently there was a little misunderstanding about your time. But that's okay, because I know how long you stayed and you'll be out of here in time. But I would like to introduce Jay Shahadi, Vice President of the Shelter and Housing of ServiceNet. And we have a new employee who has taken Danielle's place. Is that correct?
Wanda.
Yeah, Wanda.
Wanda.
Wanda, and we had a little reorganization with the Hampshire County program.
So we have Katie Marinecki, Director of Hampshire County Programs, ServiceNet. I would like to introduce our City Councilor, Mary Ann LaBarge from Ward 6 and Chair of Social Services, Veterans, Culture, and Recreation. To my right is Gina Louise Chiara, who's a counselor from Ward 4. And to my left is City Councilor from Ward 7, Alyssa Klein. So.
Well, as you know, ServiceNet has been running homeless shelters for, housing people, emergency shelters in the late 80s, early 90s, I'm not sure exactly what the time was. And over the years, it has developed a robust system of services, and this includes funding sources from Department of Housing and Community Development, the City of Northampton, through community CDBG funds, from the HUD Housing and Urban Development Federal Services, and then donations and various other sources, Project Bread, fuel assistance that helps out with feeding the shelters and the winter. So by the time we're all done, at the end of the year writing grants and having state funding, there's about 24 sources that we apply to every single year. So it's pretty much an ongoing project. It starts sometime in September, ends in May, gives us the summer off. So it's great. So today, in Hampshire County, we have 32 units of permanent housing, and we have a 20-bed shelter in the city-owned building, Grove Street. We also have just recently opened our interfaith cop shelter on Center Street. So in those, both, and that has 23?
Who does?
So there's 20 beds at the cop shelter. Both
so
those,
there's 20 beds at Grove Street and 20 beds at the cop shelter.
Yep. And then we have another overflow shelter at East Hampton at our late Sorrow Church.
Is that at the church?
Yeah, that's the church.
Basement
of the church. The basement of the
church. And that actually opens tomorrow. And there's 6 individuals that will include.
Now, we're still staying at the same capacity, which I guess is Councilor Klein mentioned about the 20 beds at Grove Street, because I know we cannot bring that up, not unless we add it on to the house.
Right.
But the cot shelter, it seems like we're staying at a level of 20. Is that the capacity? Because it seems like we have a problem, because we're still short of having shelters, even if we're using East Stanford. But that's still the problem?
Well,
we don't have enough of sites?
Well, the winter shelter that's opened, Craig Stores and Amherst, has alleviated some of that issue of being overcrowded in the shelter. On the coldest nights of the year, we won't shut our doors. We find a way to keep them shut. And last year was a very difficult year. We kept the facility open during the day. We had produced probably a $20,000 to $30,000 deficit on top of the money. providing those extra services last year. So, you know, it was not an easy year. But amazingly enough, people were fully cooperative. We didn't have a lot of issues. Our shelters that we run in Western are generally safe and quiet as compared to a more urban setting shelter.
Do you have to ever turn anybody down, like on the Center Street one?
There'll be nights when, you know, people come at 5 o'clock, they're waiting to get in, and, you know, there might be 25 people there if you talk to those doors. Then we have, you know, we collaborate with Soldier On also. They provide the transportation to East Hampton and the staff. So that's all done on a volunteer basis.
If we have to turn people away, we do some, you know, we let them know about the animal shelter, and we provide bus passes to come there.
So it's become a pretty good, you know, connected people. So, and there's times when they were full last year, and they called and said, hey, yeah, you know, yeah, we got a bed.
Which soldiers are John Downey? Which captain is probably one of the most wonderful, dedicated director that soldiers are. Do they have room up there? Say, if I'm hearing, if you are saying, if the shelter on Center Street, that you cannot accept them, but you will call soldiers on. They will be giving them a pass, or can they go to Soldiers On? There must be room up to Soldiers On.
If there was a huge issue, I would call Jack. We also collaborate with them out in Pittsfield and have, you know, increased 25 different winter beds out there also between ServiceNet and Soldier On. We do the transportation, some increase at our facility, some at their facility and the shelter. There are ways. You will not say that if we. We're starting fast with this. It's not just here, it's in Pittsfield, it's people are feeling it in Springfield.
It's higher now, huh? There's more people than
And, you know, what's happening nationwide is that they're saying that the homeless population is dropping, but they've put a lot of resources into the veterans, so the chronic veteran homeless typically dropped quite a bit. It kind of stabilizes the number, but the people that aren't involved in that system, that's going up.
What proportion of the homeless population in Northampton would you say?
In who we see, it probably runs about. We had about 20% 2 years ago. I know that number stuck in my head because Jack and I talked about it. Last year it was down a little bit because we did a better job of saying, hey, identifying. You know, because sometimes, a homeless vet will make a choice, no, I don't want to go there. So we tend to have the people that won't interact with Soldier On, but we'll still talk with their case manager. So hey, look, here's what they have. You know, they have housing subsidies, can they do anything with that? So there's been more of a coordinated effort. Last year, I think it was down about 16 to 17%. It's a problem that's going pretty well on the veteran side. It's about resources.
So at the shelter on Road Street and also on Center Street, do you get a lot of veterans there?
We have 100 people, probably anywhere from 10 to 20 bucks that circulate in and out. Yeah.
Clarify this. Soldier On doesn't actually have shelter space for just kind of overnight sheltering. Like you're talking, they have permanent housing up there.
No, they have a shelter on the Leeds campus. Yeah,
I've seen it.
Does it operate the same way that people come at the end of the day kind of thing?
Well, they will. Yeah, they'll have somebody show up. The way the veterans, they have very odd catchment areas. So this one here probably serves. It's all of Western and Massachusetts, and then Southern Vermont, New York, that slice of New York that's on that border, and then the top of, you know, and mostly Connecticut.
And how many beds do they have?
They have over 200 beds. They're big, but they're building housing on that campus for women. They took some space there, so they have that. There's Agawam. They've got a lot of housing that they're building. They're really moving forward. So that's taking them, that'll take the numbers down for us.
Are you talking about the VA on the housing for women?
Nope, this is Soldier M.
Oh.
They're the ones that develop. The VA has it. The VA case management, which is another, that's the government side. Soldier On, the nonprofit side, they have, you know, VASH, what they call veteran, you know, shelter housing program.
Well, so, you know, like the Jack Downey, I mean, who helped them even with Grove Street Inn, working very closely with Ted Keller and Social Services and Veterans Affairs, like with kitchen cabinets, whatever, because he had so much contact. You know, so you are still working closely with him.
Yeah, I've worked with Jack for probably 25 years, so we know each other well.
And what do you do?
I manage the two shelters, the Grove Street Inn Shelter and the shelter on 47th Street, the Enfield Winter Shelter. And I also oversee our 32 units, the two housing units in Florence and one in Northampton.
Where's the one in Florence?
There's one on North 17 North Maple Street and Stroud Avenue.
And everything's still on fire in the back.
Yeah, so, you know, and there is, you know, and recently there's also the, you know, the family issue we do in Greenfield and Pittsfield with the family, but we are expanding our shelter for homeless families. We case manage the Greenfield motels. We just started that about 2 months ago. There's about 87 families in those motels up there. And,
in Greenfield?
Yeah. And we're beginning to lease up apartment units.
Also,
Greenfield or Greenfield, we're starting to come this way. So families posted up so that we lease those up and, you know, have people out of the motel.
Yeah.
What is the
There's about 450 families today in motels in Massachusetts, over 2,000 statewide, and there's literally 25 families a day coming into the emergency assistance system. So it's, there's 135 families in the project.
We had some partnership come to our committee, and that was brought up about how families, you know, the mother, father, and the children living in motels, and I know of an incident that that's occurred.
Mm-hmm.
And they've been there for over a year. Small children, 2 years old and like four, they cannot find them a place to live.
So we're doing a heavy expansion of that in these counties and over because we've had a reconfiguring of the homeless services in Western Massachusetts, where Hampshire County was attached as a continuum of care that was part of Camden County.
Mm-hmm.
What has happened in the past year is that Berkshire, Franklin, and Hampshire are now a federal continuum of care.
Mm-hmm.
And so this has moved out of, the city used to oversee those hard federal funds for transitional and permanent housing. That's moved to Hilltown Community Development Corporation, overseen by them. And then the three counties, because the rural is more of a rural nature, and the issues of rural homelessness are different. The transportation, the employment issues, you know, the isolation is much different. So it's been, to this point, it's been a good thing. It's helped us leverage more funds by having, now we do all the sheltering in the three counties. For families and individuals, and that gives us more of a better grant writing process, because our system looks larger and more leverage points, and, you know, more communities that from, you know, community donations, that type. You can't get those federal funds without, you know, the community pitching in. Northampton's great, which is in, really stands behind the shelter program. And it's a good place to be business for us. But unfortunately, it's, things are on the move. Massachusetts does a great job at counting its homeless population. And so it's on the rise here, and other states, they are, is going down, but they're not as developed. And we don't have, you know, we have a resource center here where all the providers are. We know everybody is in good working collaboration. So you can find anybody that's touching homeless services in Hampshire County will use our center to resource center.
Is there concern with the change in the gubernatorial administration that things will get harder or maybe significantly different, you suppose?
I don't think it's going to have a major impact on us. That's just my thought. I think that the current undersecretary, Aaron Gorenstein, he has a knowledge, he's in the private sector dealing with this issue, and so he knows what's going on, and he knows what the issues are. I hope they retain him. I think that the person that they have just, from Chelsea, that's the new Department of Housing, is going to come in to head up that Department of Housing Community Development. I know that he has a good relationship with him, so hopefully he'll stay on this track and, you know, and continue. It's a tough issue with family home, individual homelessness. It's really, you know, people are falling out of other state services and they're with us, and that's their last stop on continuing the services. You know, we're not a real treatment program, we try to be, but, you know, we don't have that kind of resource. And that's what the advantage of having Center Street is, because you have, it increases our case management, because the South Middlesex Opportunity Council's case manager comes, and LA Homeless Services, that case, you know, and they're all small groups of case managers, but when you put them all in the same room, it's a pretty good team, and it's a nice collaboration. Well, I can deal with that person. I know him, let me take that so that around the table saying, who works best for this individual?
Say what with the Grove story again.
Mm-hmm.
How many staff now? During the winter time, they're there all day, right? If the weather is cold, they're not sent out. They're there all day. So what is the ratio of staff? If you have 20 beds, you have 20 people, how much is the staffing of 24 hours a day?
We have one overnight staff, and generally there is, you can say, 1.5 on the 4 to 11 shift.
So one overnight staff.
Mm-hmm.
I just have some concerns here because of behaviors, which do happen, it does occur. What is the procedure? One staff person, 20 individuals at that home, how does that one person handle that behavior besides whoever is in there, the 19 other, okay? How do you accommodate their concerns of not being frightful?
Well, believe me, it's something that we wrestle with. We don't have the money to, you know, I mean, over the years, the staffing level has dropped. In the 6 years I've been overseeing all the shelter programs at Service Net, when I first came on board, we had more staffing on the second shift than there was one over the year. But, you know, as we suffered a little cut here, a cut there, you know, we didn't get as much fuel assistance, we didn't get as much inside the shelter. All that stuff starts to, you know, come down. You know, I mean, we're running pretty much a year-round program there on about $235,000. It goes pretty quickly. Because the cost of doing business keeps going up. We have these mandates that have the computer system, enter all the data into the homeless management information system. That's what, you know, that's what the country is. You know, we have an iCall system. You know, my phone's never off. Katie's never off. You know, we have a lot of, you know, our staff all participate in that. We are fortunate that, you know, we've had the acts of violence that occurred in any of these shelters.
It has happened.
It's maybe once.
Because I know of an incident. But my question is, that one person on the night shift, is that an awake staff or is it an overnight sleep? Because some places do do that. There's responsibility for the people in one staff.
That's about the ratio that exists in most of these. If you went to, you know, downtown friends, you know, and you know, there's 137 people in there, and they're giving them, and probably they have about 1%.
And what about Center Street? What's the overnight staffing there?
Also
one person.
Mm-hmm. The person sleeping there.
And the yes, and they overnight sleep.
So there's two, one overnight and one person awake.
Mm-hmm.
And if that person should have a problem or a behavior problem, awakes that person.
Mm-hmm.
Right. That's good. Yeah, I would feel better
if we just need more volunteers.
Yeah. You know, it's just the resource just isn't there. You know, it's quite hard just to keep the doors open. We're probably the most under-resourced state. And I've worked with every state agency, and every service, and
You've been with service net for how long?
6 years.
How long?
6 years.
Thank you, all the hard work that all your staff do. And taking care of our families.
Thank you. Always.
We're not getting any snow this year.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Does it feel that terrible that you call yourself a lamp?
It's just the layers are
sad. You know, we should get like a lamp that just shines
down. No, it's not terrible at all. Well, it used to be when you would have these meetings, you actually sat around.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
You're welcome. No.
It's fine. I don't think that they were recorded either. I mean, in the beginning, so it was a little bit more informal.
Well, if anything, it would be better if people sat around because
you're
faster to the camera.
Exactly. That's the way I like it.
I didn't have hair and makeup today. You could have had masks clearly on the back of your head.
Penny, I want to thank you again, Penny Burke, who is the executive director of the Northampton Center of the Arts. And Richard Wagner, thank you for being here, President of the Board of the Northampton Community Art Trust. I'm City Councilor Marianne LaBarge from Ward 6. I'm the Chair of Social Services, Veterans, Cultural, and Recreation. To my right is Councilor Gina Louise Sierra from Ward 4, and to my left is City Councilor Alyssa Kwan. So, we need to talk. So, we've invited both Penny and Richard to come today and see if we can open the doors to a problem, apparently, that we'd like to solve with you if we can.
Well, I have to say, I'm not gonna necessarily couch this in terms of being a problem. I think that the topic for conversation was really, what is, if anything, the relationship between the Northampton Center for the Arts and the City of Northampton? And as I have explained, in a previous meeting, and in, you know, off the record conversations with Marianne, legally, in terms of ordinances, there's no longer any relationship between the city and the Northampton and Center for the Arts. We have a loose relationship because of First Night, because the city funds a small portion of First Night, but the city definitely supports the event in terms of services. There's no question about it. I feel there are probably things that I would have said that I'm not going to say right now. Because, you know, this recent development with the bid has a huge impact on us, the Center for the Arts, and it obviously has an impact on the city. And I feel almost as if, you know, this meeting was scheduled a long time ago, and I realize that the purpose of it is not to discuss that relationship. But I think that that's going to be a game changer in terms of a future relationship with them. I mean it. Mm-hmm. You know, I do. You know, the city was responsible for basically creating, the city designated the Northampton Center for the Arts as the stewards, shall we say?
Stewardship.
We were the city basically held the lease of the building on Sullivan Square, and the Center for the Arts was formed as an independent nonprofit, but it was very much formed, you can't go back, but at the time Mayor Musanti had a huge hand in that, and the original board of the Center for the Arts was appointed by the mayor. So the two were inextricably attached in the beginning. The city itself was committed to the success, really, of the Center for the Arts, and why shouldn't they have been? It was a community arts center. And probably, I would say, a year after the center was incorporated, their director got the idea to start First Night. The reason I'm only bringing it up, because the Center for the Arts has been and always will be way more than First Night, that was really the relationship that became sustained over the years. When I became director of the Center for the Arts, which was 10 years ago, our relationship to the city pretty much had to do with a repeated series of challenges, shall we say, that developed as occupants, as tenants in the building at 17 New South Street, because the original purchase and sale agreement that the city had was with one developer, and that developer sold the building to another. Why does any of this matter? It actually doesn't. I'm just saying that I used to have regular contact with the mayor, with Terry Anderson in her capacity. I think she was like called community development coordinator.
Mm-hmm.
We actually, unfortunately, had some interactions that involved the city solicitor. In other words, the city, there simply was a relationship there had to be, because they were the leaseholder. Once the lease expired,
We contacted you about coming again, because this is the second time since we have been part of the council. We were hoping that you would come with some really concrete suggestions about ways in which we might be able to help to facilitate more of a solid relationship with the city, and I'm wondering if you did come equipped kind of with some really concrete ideas of what we might be able to do.
What would you like the relationship to look like? I have to say it's hard to answer that question, since there all of a sudden is no more bid, because in a way they were kind of a crossover. We acted as kind of their cultural, kind of a cultural arm, and they facilitated events that we had. So I kind of envisioned, well, let me go back. I've been told, and please correct me if I'm wrong, because you're the city councilors and I'm not, that the only type of relationship that the Center for the Arts could have with the city would have something to do with the creation of an ordinance. We no longer have an ordinance that relates the city in any way to the Center for the Arts. There was an ordinance that was on the books that said the mayor appoints the board of the Northampton Center for the act. I think that, you know, I'm going to kind of turn to Richard, you know, but I have to, because it's hard to talk about the Center for the Arts without talking about the with the Arts Trust, you know. Once we lost our venue, and once we, you know, threw our hat into the ring with the Arts Trust, which is another organization whose mission is basically to, you know, sustain and support arts in a physical space, which is very similar to the Center for the Arts mission, I think what we're looking for is some kind of formal, but not financial, support that can be written into the books that would accommodate this.
Could you look at that, please? Now, the Center of Arts, you have all the directors, right?
Yes.
And they were involved also with Terry Anderson and whoever the players were involved with the Center of Arts. When Councilor Owen Freeman Daniels came aboard with that, did you know about that ordinance happening?
Well, you mean that the ordinance was going to be deleted? Yeah, if I knew it in advance, the ordinance was going to be deleted. I mean, I think we've gone through this before.
No,
it's a very awkward situation because the mayor knew that our lease was expiring, because we had gone to the mayor and we'd said, we're not sure that we have any place to go. This was when the Arts Trust was formed, but we didn't have a place to go. And we were told by the mayor that he would help us at least find a temporary office. And what seemed to become apparent was that if there was no longer an ordinance on the books, then the city had basically no impetus, no reason necessarily to support the Center for the Arts, even in terms of providing office space. And this was requested, as far as I can understand, that this ordinance be deleted because we were supposedly non-compliant, because the ordinance read that the Center for the Arts should have a board of directors appointed by the mayor. And that was the original ordinance.
Mm-hmm.
And then I told you this before, it became a self-sustaining board. And nobody ever went back and changed the ordinance. But you know, from my perspective, it was kind of a catch. It was kind of a catch 22. Nothing we could do about it. You can't.
But ordinances can come back.
But I mean, you described the relationship as previously being more like the city was a landlord. So I assume that's not really the kind of relationship you'd like. But I guess what we're still asking is what kind of relationship would you like, regardless of ordinances or whatnot. But what would you like the relationship to be? And you said formal but not financial.
Well, I have to say not financial, because there's no, I mean, there
what is formal?
There's no money. Well, I suppose, I mean, what do I mean?
I'm the new landlord.
You're the new landlord.
Thank you.
You're the new landlord.
I mean, I think there's formal and there's informal. And informal, I can imagine things that I think are already happening to some extent, which is letters of support for proposals, press releases going out about events. I think that we need to think creatively about the ways in which the city can, you know,
let me give them a little more specific. You know, there is an arts council that again, since the last time we had this meeting, has been reinvented. One of the things that we were pushing very, very strong for was actually some kind of integration of the Center for the Arts with the Arts Council under the umbrella of something called an Arts and Culture Department. That's already been created, but it's been created without us. So I would just say that, you know, I feel like, you know, the train left the station, and we're on the other side of the tracks. I mean, there's nothing, things literally have happened since the last time we got together. And I feel you can't go back and change something that exists. I personally, and this has nothing to do with the Arts Trust, this has to do with the Center for the Arts. I would have liked, after 10 years of being involved in public arts in the city and events that benefit
the community and the parks in the city to have been included in the conversation about a reinvention of who represents arts in the city. If you go back, and this is such an ancient history here, but if you go back and you look at that old cultural plan that was formed, this was a collaboration among a number of organizations, but primarily the Arts Council, the Center for the Arts, and actually the arts in the school system. You know.
Is there no one that's involved with the Center for the Arts that's involved now with the Arts Council?
Not in any way? Not in any way.
And is there some reason why there hasn't been an exploration of having somebody on the Arts Council that is directly involved with the Center for the Arts?
No, but up until recently, I mean, I feel as if the Arts Council itself has been redefined, and I don't yet understand it based on this new department. In other words, I've been told it's an advisory board or an advisory council. I think that it was a way of separating the city department from a 501c3.
Mm-hmm.
You know, initially, it wouldn't have made, I have to say to tell you, it wouldn't have made sense for a member of the board of the Center for the Arts to be on the Arts Council, because the Arts Council was literally reviewing these grants, you know, and we were providing the venue for many of these things to take place. So there was a relationship, but I don't know that it would have been appropriate, let's put it that way, for us to be sitting on the board. What I'm trying to suggest is that I feel that there was a, too late now again, a kind of a missed opportunity, but maybe not, to collaborate in some form. We end up, the Center for the Arts, sort of being involved in all of the things that for whatever reason the Arts Council, but it's something different now, is not interested in doing. Example, Arts Night Out. Originally, when that committee was formed to take that event over from the Chamber of Commerce. Our informal group thought it would be best that the Arts Council act as fiscal sponsor, because that seemed the right thing to do. The Arts Council board at that time, 4 years ago or something, 3 or 4 years ago, said that wasn't a part of their mission. That's when we picked it up. A very small thing, but as an example, right now there's an effort that's being made by the UMass Extension Office to do a series of arts entrepreneurship, I don't know if that's seminars or workshops or whatever. And originally, both the Arts Council and the Center for the Arts and other arts people in Northampton were involved. Just the way the cards fell is the Center for the Arts. I'm acting as a representative of arts from Northampton with Burns Maxey, who's the city arts person from East Hampton. But we actually are a little, we're both arts people, but we're kind of apples and oranges arts people, because she's a city employee and I'm whatever I am, you know? So I feel as if we, you know, again, I've been seeing what the mayor has presented in terms of what he envisions this new department to be. I assume that you meet with Brian Foote as well, and Brian can probably explain that to you, but I mean, I feel like I would have liked to have been
part of it.
Well, I would have liked to have been included in the conversation, because it's been on the Center for the Arts agenda for a number of years. That was one of the ways that we thought we might be able to reinvent ourselves if we were unable to find a venue. Now, it looks like we have a new landlord, so.
Mm-hmm.
So true. But you know, I mean, you can speak in terms of the Arts Trust, the support of the city has been.
Well, the city, look, we're a private nonprofit, C3, we came together because people had a mission in mind. I came aboard later than Penny, certainly. But it was a real clear mission to acquire and protect and provide affordable space for creative work. Happens that they needed it, knew it was time was coming up, or at least come up. So last October we got the building on Holly Street, and
since we got it, the city support has, in my estimation, has been where a city can offer you support, which is letters of confidence and recommendation when going for grants. Having the city make us aware if a grant pops up, that happened once, would be greater. It'd be great if it happened more.
That definitely should happen more often. I will say that during the years that Terry was, yeah, and Anderson was here, for whatever reason, it was more incorporated in her job. I don't think a week or two went by then I wouldn't get a grant recommendation. Not that all of them were, you know.
I said, yeah, you won.
Yes, you did.
Yeah. Sounds like someone's pursuing it too.
That's right. Someone is pursuing it.
Yeah.
And I've offered to help with that grant process too. So
no, and that's, and believe me, that's, you know, that's important, right?
Yeah. But no, and it's important. And it's important for the Arts Trust, but I mean, you know, right now, our mission is money, because we want to renovate the building, we need to renovate the building. And right now, the Center for the Arts is running stuff out of the building, and they can do it on a, not a grand scale, but a small scale, because we shut those 2/3 of the building down, to overwinter, because it's so massive and leaking, you know.
But
not
we're not generating any revenue.
But no,
for ourselves.
Yeah.
The big, you know, and this is not something that you're necessarily here to do. And we're gonna be in trouble in a little while, but
yeah,
hopefully
yeah,
not. But I mean, we're not generating revenue, and we do have a mission and have had an important mission.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to us, our mission, our mission is as important as the Academy of Music.
Mm-hmm.
We're not a beautiful historical Cassini stage theater, but we always have been a place where artists have been able to show small works and small companies have been able to work, and this is what we're missing here right now.
And which is also why you can't get any CPA dollars or
anything of
that sort, because we're not historic.
That's right.
Historic. You know, Holly Street. And again, and it's hard, there are too many Northampton plus arts sort of organizations in Northampton to keep them all straight sometimes, because people get us very confused. But the Arts Trust, we're about providing the space. We're not programming per se. Our first order of business is to get a good envelope on that building, put a new roof on, tighten it up, and make it so that it could be run as cheaply as possible in terms of energy costs and whatnot. But, you know, we made a play for Union Station. In the knowledge that, boy, if we got Union Station, we could go for CPA funds, because that's a historic structure, and you could get historic tax dollars and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
No offense to Holly Street. it's not a historic building.
Right, right. So, you know,
so
maybe
it's
that's not one of the missions of the CPA. Well,
yeah, no,
that's
exactly
right. Unfortunately,
yeah,
it's not something.
Yeah, exactly.
Control,
so
that would be nice if that,
yeah,
was.
But
right.
So
and that would have, and if we had Union Station, I think that built in, there would have been a built in relationship with the city because of CPA, also because of a certain amount of municipal parking that
existed. And the
there.
Train, I mean, that was
and
easy.
The train.
That was easy to see how that would be woven together. Holly Street, you know, we're doing it on our own, basically, because that's the way it's come down. We're going to have to ask other individuals for big amounts of cash and small amounts of cash. When grants come up that we think we can get, we'll be coming to the mayor's office and individual counselors and saying, hey, we need a lot of support for this.
Do you have someone following grants and really kind of keeping your fingers on the pulse of what comes from the state and other private foundations?
I wouldn't say somebody keeping finger on the pulse of what's coming out of the state, but there are three of us who are, four or five, who are core fundraising, and we have, had some consultants on hire. And we're working on putting a grant package together, and we've won two grants.
We have two grants already.
Two grants, one from the Cultural Facilities Fund, which will go to not this cycle, but the following cycle, and one from the executive office of finance and administration for tourism in Western, for supporting tourism in
And that,
Western
by the
Mass.
Way, was a fluke. So yeah, anybody who finds a fluke, send it our way. No, I mean seriously, when I say
it
a
was.
Fluke, we stumbled across a grant within 2 days of the deadline and actually got
yeah.
it. So we realized that, you know, even I think if someone had been keeping a finger on the pulse, they would have missed that one, because that one was way under the radar and turned out to
yeah.
be pretty...
It was great.
It was great.
It was great.
It was
but I mean,
terrific.
it was under Google's radar.
Right.
It was
way under there. But just to, you know, when we don't have that much time, but to wind up a little bit about it. I mean, personally now at this point, I'm interested in seeing what the city is creating in terms of a new arts office, let's say. I think it's hard to find a place for us in something that we're not quite sure what it is. And when I've mentioned the bid a couple of times, and even though the bid is null and void and wasn't a city organization, in a certain way, that was a very good crossover for us. The Center for the Arts was basically the arts and events arm of the bid. We weren't in the business of making a lot of money, but we were working together to keep downtown vibrant through the arts. And right now, as I sit here, I mean, this has been, you know, it's less than a week. It's a game changer. So, you know, I'm not trying to postpone things, but I'm saying I personally am feeling kind of disoriented and dislocated by this latest change, because for us, that was a good partnership. And it was a good partnership for downtown and a good partnership for the city. And the city did have a defined relationship with the Bay.
Do you have a relationship with the chamber? And is the chamber, do you think they will pick up any of the kind of arts activities in the city?
Well, you know, this is also, I'm working right now with someone at the chamber about at least, you know, an interim. I mean, you can imagine, this couldn't have come at a more difficult time
mm-hmm.
in a way, between, you know, holiday lights, first night, we've all got to make it happen. But I think that what's likely to happen because of the timeline is that something will be cobbled together that will grow from the chamber. Whether the chamber would want to sustain that, I can't speak for them. I mean, I know that we ended up, as that's the Center for the Arts, becoming a fiscal sponsor for Arts Night Out because the chamber, they just didn't feel it fell within their purview anymore. As they have become more involved in this regional tourism effort, they were less focused on downtown. That's what, I don't know, things you already know. We ended up with the bid, but we don't have a bid anymore, so we're going to have to build a better mousetrap, I guess.
Who are you dealing with at the chamber thing?
Right now? You mean for, I mean, I don't regularly, like, deal with anybody at the chamber, but right at this moment, I'm working with Bud Stockwell, who's the executive committee, and this is very new. This is like since today. Emails over the weekend, since today, and there's a meeting on Thursday.
And Suzanne Beckham, which is very motivated into being involved in mostly everything throughout the city, she lives on our road and I can't remember.
I know. She's my neighbor.
I know.
She changed. But I don't think, I mean, I'm not.
I mean, I'm really sad about this whole thing. I'm going to be honest here. And it bothers me hearing, because I remember way back when you were at the D.A. Sullivan School, and I remember Mary Casper, everybody highly involved, working together. And then all of a sudden, I was shocked when you told me what had happened here. It's like, I have to agree, because why have we not? Why has not the Center for the Arts been asked to sit down with the Arts Council and have a meeting and make suggestions and to be just left out? It's like, I don't get it. I don't understand it. It's like, it's not
but
right.
There's been, you know, also there's been big changes in the Arts Council since Bob Sylvan retired. Bob Sylvan is one of the members of the board of the Arts Trust. So things are just changing. I feel like, though, in terms of the art scene right now, with what's happening with the bid, with the mayor doing a reorganization, I feel a lot of flux, you know. Mm-hmm. I really do. And because it's a certain time of the year for me, and my focus is on just getting this one event done, but now my focus is on keeping Arts Night Out going, and so I think I expect that maybe the city will become maybe more involved because we have to reinvent a bit in what they did, which was more than just cleaning the sidewalks in the snow. It we work hand in hand with them on these events and support of art in downtown. So somehow I think we've got to find a way to bring that all together. Mm-hmm. Is that going to come out of the chamber? I don't know. Well, that's the way I don't even have any choice.
Right.
Better make some lemonade.
This has come to show.
Right, absolutely. Right. So as far as specific recommendations, I just feel like right now the jury is a little out. I think we have to wait and see what some of the next steps are going to be.
What Gina Louise is saying is really true, that we're also, it's a moment of opportunity, and I'm just wondering if, you know, you can't sit with all of your advisors and boards and anybody that, you know, is really close to what is going on internally for you guys, and figure out, you know, in this moment when everything is changing, are there certain concrete requests that you would like to make, and are there certain meetings that we could maybe help to facilitate, get set up?
Mm-hmm.
Just think creatively and know that, you know, we're willing to talk to you about them. I can't commit to, you know, just anything at this point, but I certainly feel committed to seeing that you flourish. And if there's a way in which we can have the city involved in that process, I'd like to, but unfortunately, I don't have the time to kind of create those ideas, but if you actually come to me and I can serve as a facilitator, and I think that's probably true for everyone on this committee, you know, we're really making that offer very sincerely, so, you know, it doesn't have to be in one of these fora that you come in and tell us. You can
no, that's
send
important.
Us email,
I think
pick up
really,
the phone and let us know
as I said, we need the Center for the Arts, anyway, we need to have an understanding of exactly how a newly revised, reorganized Arts Council is going to function, and how, if there's any way that we can be incorporated or affiliated. And at the same time, we also have to find a way to keep our, just keep our stake in downtown arts events. Arts Night Out is a big thing, and I'm not sure where we're going to have to go to overlap. So, as I said, it's all pretty new, but I'd be more than happy to approach you again to something specific.
I mean, do you feel like you would need us to broker a meeting with Brian and members of the Arts Council, or is that something that you can initiate? I'm
trying
to be concrete here. But I've just heard you say that you'd like to be involved in that process, and so I'm wondering.
Well,
is that something
I feel like,
to
I have to be honest, I feel like I would have liked to have been involved in something that I read about in the paper, you know, but what's the point of, you know, you can't go back. You can't change that. So I'm just waiting to see what it is and to see. And yes,
but I think Councilor Klein is correct of what she's just saying. Yes, we know something has happened here. You were not involved, but she's asking about possibly breaking the walls. See if we can get in there and let everybody sit down and put their heads together and see what we can do.
Mm-hmm. I think she's going in the right direction.
Well, I'm just saying that if we can facilitate something, please
let us
know. If you would rather go directly to the people that there needs to be discussion with.
I think sometimes a facilitator is a good idea.
Mm-hmm.
So, like I said, I'm just not sure what I'm... I have to be honest. I don't really even know what's going on. So as soon as I catch up, then I think...
Have you read the language? Can you send me the
language?
I mean, I just don't know what it's
going to
look
I haven't read anything.
Well, we can through, I mean, it's all on the city website.
Right.
We can make sure.
I probably would have by now had to do a big hiccup last week.
We can make sure you see the language, but what it means in reality is
I'd like
a different story, which we can't actually get into.
Understood.
We're here to help with the best
we
can.
We know that.
And I think Alyssa is going to go in the right direction.
Okay.
Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. That wasn't anything. That wasn't directed at you.
Our first guest got here 45 minutes later than we thought they were coming, so we flipped the agenda.
Okay, so just so you know, I did bring for you the minutes from the last public hearing plus the resolution on Blackbird Sidewalk traffic for that discussion, but apparently
we're all set. We read them. They're approved.
Thank you for bringing.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for taking us by.
Yeah.
But also, because we're using the next meeting to do the main discussion,
yeah.
That's when we really kind of chew them up.
Okay. Motion is approved. Okay. Here we go.